Hey YouTube, welcome back to another History Teacher Reacts video. Mr. Terry, as I continue my search for historical knowledge found here on YouTube. All right, today's video was the result of this week's Patrons Pick poll. So every week I post a poll on Patreon and our patron pledgers can choose. And they voted on this video this week, which is, was there friendly fire in ancient battles by the channel Invicta? So I thought this was an interesting thing because we hear about how common, actually how really common friendly fire has been in battles in recent history due to things like being at far distances with each other, so not being able to see that, and the modern weaponry can be more explosive and that sort of thing, whereas in ancient times you were very close, like face to face and very, very close, making it possibly easier to differentiate somebody by how they look and if you know them and what they wear and those sort of things. So I think this is kind of interesting thing is, was there friendly fire in ancient battle? So I'm wondering if they're going to go through some sources that maybe talk about that in maybe famous battles or something like that. What would be the evidence of this sort of thing? I would think it would just come from that, and how it would be done. So I think it's a really interesting thing. I really like this idea. I think it really helped me as a teacher as well. So hopefully you'll find this interesting too. Now, as always, if you go down below, there will be a link to the original video down there. And it's important that you go click that link and that'll give them a view. And do a like, subscription for those guys, and that would be fantastic there, okay? And if you haven't subbed to my channel, I'd love to have you around too. Hit that sub button, enable notifications, so come hang out with us in live streams. And if you want to get involved in polls in the future, you can join our Patreon too. Link is down below, starts $1 a month if you want to join. If not, very, very cool. All right, let's go ahead and get started. So was there friendly fire in ancient battles? What do you think right now? Do you think that was a thing? I mean, it has to be some aspect, but do you think it was much of a thing? Let's find out.
When discussing battles, we have the modern advantage of experiencing them through simple, clear-cut diagrams. Unfortunately, reality never is so simple. Rather than experiencing combat like this, our ancestors experienced it like this. Having a hard time telling what's going on? How about now?
I mean, just think, how many people are actually at the front line? Now, it depends here. If you're using like a Roman phalanx or something like this, you move as one unit there. By the way, ignore all the white I am painting. but yeah, you would be, you know, very close together. And yeah, only a few people are actually in the front with vision. So, I mean, when you get, and one thing I know about open battles, is it actually like Assassin's Creed Odyssey, where you do those battles, the nation battles, and you go in, and it's just like random chaos of trying to find people. Obviously, it's not going to really be like that, but would this be a common thing you would see?
This all goes to show that visibility on the battlefield was clearly imperfect, even under the best conditions. This raises the question, was friendly fire an issue? A huge thanks is owed to Ancient Warfare Magazine for sponsoring this video.
Oh, that's cool.
Well,
that's a thing.
When it comes to friendly fire...
Ancient Warfare Magazine? Do they sponsor them? That'd be pretty cool to check out. Let's just look real quick at some of the things that they have. Like the articles. Ancient Rome in Turmoil, the Year of for the Four Emperors. Oh, that'd be cool. Batavian Revolt, Trouble in Judea, Battles at Bedriacum, Problem of the First Cohort Massacre. Okay. Athenian Cavalry, Hoplites in Battle, just kind of skimming around. Pretty cool. PTSD in Ancient Rome on the one on the right. Anyone get this? Is this good?
To Ancient Warfare Magazine for sponsoring this video. Well, when it comes to friendly fire,
maybe had an article in it.
This will generally occur for the following reasons. Collateral damage, panicked flight, and misidentification. Let's now take a look at each of these. The first category is the most straightforward, and basically just means that troops accidentally hit their comrades in the process of attempting to target the enemy. This might
So like an archer providing ranged attacks. I mean, you have to be so accurate, you never know. It'd be hard. I could see that happening.
Occur
for sure.
In close quarters combat, if someone mishandled their sword or spear.
Did you see this guy? Hold on, in the animation.
Troops accidentally hit their comrades in the process of attempting to target the enemy.
Okay, this guy right here. See my mouse? This guy's gonna end up Getting friendly fire
might occur in close quarters combat if someone mishandled their sword or spear. While we don't really have any records of this sort of thing occurring,
some of them are a little anxious there. Is this from a game? What game is this from?
Seems almost inevitable that it would have happened every once in a while. Roman commanders such as Caesar were careful to ensure that their troops maintained proper spacing to allow them to fight more effectively and avoid such issues.
Well, yeah, even like if you're swinging, you know, you could hit somebody, poke someone's eye out or something.
Friendly fire could also be a risk from ranged weapons. Typically, skirmishers fought each other in the opening stages of battle before retreating behind the main line to wait out the fight or move to support the flanks. In this case, commanders were always careful to stop firing once hand-to-hand combat was underway. It would be rare for units like archers to continue to fire upon the main battle lines into mixed combat. We do have some records of it happening, though, when weather conditions like wind caused volleys to accidentally swerve into friendly forces.
So environmental things like that, yeah, wind pattern change. Maybe the wind's coming right at you. That'd probably be a common one if it's coming right at you, which causes your arrow to come short and dip down, for sure.
A little closer to the front lines, it was also pretty common for troops to hurl close-range javelins or even stones at each other. Once again, we could...
Throwing a javelin against a shield an enemy? How effective of a weapon could that really be? I mean, that thing's so big, right? And you're going to use it, and you could, you know, you're probably not going to hit somebody that's shielded and prepared, right? Maybe for a surprise attack, and then, you know, it gets blocked, and all of a sudden you've given your enemy a weapon, right?
Imagine some of these being thrown a little too low and hitting an ally in the back.
Right in the back of the head.
This sort of collateral damage was more of a freak accident than a common occurrence. Another important type of friendly fire to discuss will be in cases of panic. Now, this was a common occurrence since typically all battles ended when one side eventually broke and fled. In fact, most casualties during actual combat would be in the low 1 to 5%, with the real terrible damage being inflicted upon the retreat.
You know, This is a great point he's making about how actually low casualties could be in a fight. You know, 1 to 5% of people actually die because eventually you just retreat. And it brings to mind how warfare is different, because you didn't see that in some of the first modern battles. Let me talk about World War One, for example. So one of the things that was different about World War One as compared to something like this is those casualty rates, right? Because these battles, you wouldn't just drop and run. You couldn't. It wasn't like that. It wasn't common. And here it's like, this is where you get this glory of battle idea. There was kind of this idea that World War One, it wasn't the war to end all wars, but it was the war to change all wars. Because, and this was coming from writers and like people writing journals, is, you know, they had been taught about the glory of war like this, where your actual chances of dying in a battle could be very small. Because you would either outrun the enemy and they would retreat, or you would retreat before it got too bad. And that wasn't happening with more devastating weaponry like World War One. And I remember hearing about that, where a soldier was like, hey, we've been taught about this, about the glory of warfare, about these glorious charges that you would make like this. You'd make this charge and it would scare the enemy and you'd even avoid the fight. And that was like the glory and heroic part of warfare. And with stalemates like World War One, that idea died of that, the glorious, like, they used to be cavalry infantry charges that, you know, their forefathers had passed down to them in World War One. And it was like, there was no glory in fighting, like in modern warfare, like World War One. There was no glory in sitting in a trench waiting to be blown up, because there was nothing like this, because any of those glorious charges ended with a mass slaughter. This is where you get the difference and why war had been passed down as this like glorious thing, because you would have these kind of moments that you do not have these anymore. Not in the modern era of warfare.
Now, generally, the casualties here would be dealt by the victorious soldiers who pursued on foot or more likely on horse. But in these situations, friendly forces could be just as deadly. This might simply be the case of people being trampled to death by a crowd as an entire battle line disintegrated into a mass of fleeing bodies. In a lot of cases, though, battle lines would break apart bit by bit. Sometimes, units that attempted to flee would be blocked by their own soldiers. In these instances, we have numerous records to support the idea that fleeing soldiers would readily hack through their own lines to reach safety.
Mm-hmm. Officer, because at some point you trigger your survival instinct where if you got a mob, it's like Black Friday, right? People just plowing through stuff because they're trying to get through and they don't care about what they're trampling over. And that would happen there. It's your survival instinct. If you're getting overrun, you're going to get to where you need to be at anything possible. And one thing I would think too is it seems like you could be startled easy. Like, okay, you're fighting shoulder to shoulder, you know, you're fighting an open battlefield. And then all of a sudden you bump up, right, into your compatriot there, your squad mate. And, you know, you get pushed and your immediate reaction is going to be, you know, turn and, you know, defend yourself, and you might actually kill them. I can see that being just a reactionary thing. You hit and you don't know who that's going to be, so you react that way.
Officers might attempt to hold the line and even strike down fleeing soldiers to reinstill discipline, but this would only make them a larger target for the truly desperate in the grips of Phobos. This very thing had happened to Caesar at Dyrrhachium when he was nearly killed by a fleeing soldier whilst attempting to rally the line. Apparently, some armies were ready for this sort of thing and barred the way, ready to stop or even kill any who attempted to flee. The Roman Triarii were to be employed in this way as a last line of defense against both friend and foe. Some Germanic tribes apparently...
You mean like, don't allow someone to flee the battle? You're like, hey, no, you're staying up there. We haven't been given the retreat signal yet.
Even had their women and children in the back lines ready to kill any cowards who retreated.
Oh, really? You have the wives and the kids. Dad, don't be a wuss. Stay in there. You're not coming back. We know the Spartan women were all about that, but the Germanic women, it's interesting. So they're pretty burly, tough women. It's like, hey, if you're coming back from war, it's because you won, not because you retreated.
So yeah, in the case of panicked flight, I'd say friendly fire was actually quite common. Next up, we have cases of misidentification.
This seems like it could be the most common thing. If you are, especially if you're dressed similarly, you know, in hand-to-hand combat, close-range combat, you know, it's not as important what you would, like wearing camouflage or something like that. So I could help if you were like the British and have a bright red coat. It'd be a red coat because it's like anything you, if you're ever fighting, you're at a range where you can identify yourself and you can be identified. It's not secretive, so it doesn't matter if the enemy sees you, right? But in older times, because I'd wondered about this, about misidentification, is misidentification more common back then, or is that actually more common now? Because now everything's very much, because there's so much distance and so much stealth involved now that you are trying not to be seen, to be discerned from your surroundings.
The idea here is that soldiers attack a target intentionally, but as a result of some confusion taking place. In approaching this topic, we will have to consider how soldiers identified their enemies in the first place. Well, to put things simply, the rank and file soldier basically attacked whatever was in front of them, and it would be the job of the general to aim them in the right direction. The way this worked is that the commander would navigate the army on a strategic level. A foe would be located through intelligence gathering, with one or both armies closing the distance for a fight. At this point, the battle plans would be drawn, and the armies deployed in accordance to these plans. As we discussed in a previous video, these sorts of battle plans in the past were really quite simple, due to the limited and rigid nature of ancient combat as compared to our vast and fluid modern equivalent. Skirmishers would typically screen the deployment of the armies, but once the main lines were ready, they would advance in pretty much a straight line. To the average soldier on the ground, the enemy would start off as a blurred line on the horizon. As they approached, horses could be distinguished from the men, and banners would be seen waving in the wind. Soon after, individual soldiers could be made out. At this point, it would be rather easy to identify the enemy. Distinctive equipment,
sure, at this
cultural
moment.
Appearances, banners, emblems, and war cries would all be a major indicator of whom one was fighting. As a Roman, it would be fairly easy to tell who was a Greek, a barbarian, or a Persian. But what would happen if the enemy was a Roman, as was all too often the case in the civil wars? Well, things might be a little more tricky, since weapons, language, behavior, and appearance were pretty similar. The sort of confusion that could result from this is best evidenced by the Battle of Delium in 424 BC during the Peloponnesian War, often cited as the first historical record of friendly...
So we got Spartans or Sparta and their allies versus Athens and their allies. That's the Peloponnesian War. So, yeah, since you're common Greeks, you're going to be speaking the same language, might dress similarly. So that's something like that definitely makes sense that there would be potential for higher... casualties for your own group.
Fire. Athenian hoplites attempted to surround a unit of thespians, but in the process ended up bumping into their own ranks and fighting one another. It is often thought that in this instance, the Athenians were not employing any specific identifiers on their shield. However, individual legions were actually fairly well differentiated by their standards and shield patterns. Since they typically stayed as a single unit rather than being split up in a civil war, the differences between armies would be pretty apparent.
So, I mean, it makes sense. Like, the writing your group and all that stuff there, it's not just about pride in your group. It's logistical. It's like, hey, because the thing you're going to see, the first thing you're going to see with a soldier is what's on their shields, the biggest part. And hey, you can identify that, like, you know, hey, they have a red shield and stuff like that. So it's going to be somebody that, you know, you're going to be there. So, cause it doesn't really matter. It doesn't matter if the enemy knows, I mean, they know. So it's more important that you can differentiate amongst yourselves than decoy the others, especially in a close quarters combat.
Judging by history, the Romans didn't really have too much trouble with these affairs. So we can conclude that proper identification was just not a big deal.
Sure.
Yet precautions were still taken. Often, armies would employ special passwords or chants to identify one another. Other times, units might be ordered to alter their appearance by, for example, fastening colored cloth on their person or by leaving one shoulder bare, as was the case with Caesar's Gallic auxiliaries. But even this could not
entirely... Is that risky, though? You're going to leave yourself unarmored in a very visible spot, like a shoulder? It's a place that... you can easily get swiped at.
...entirely prevent rare cases of friendly fire. Our most common examples take place in truly chaotic situations, like night battles or sieges. I'll share two anecdotes to this effect. The first has to do with the Athenian invasion of Sicily. The situation was that the Athenians and their allied forces from Argos were attempting to attack the Syracusans at night. On the approach, the Argives began singing a war song in their native Dorian Greek, a dialect which was different than the allied Athenian Attic Greek, but was actually the same as the enemy Syracusans Greek. The result.
See the issue there. You know, language is such a big thing, it's such an identifying common mark of any culture that, yeah, not a good idea. What are they singing for anyways?
Was that in the darkness, the Athenians panicked and attacked the group chanting in a foreign tongue.
Oh.
Apparently, the Argives attempted to clear up the issue by shouting out the code word. However, the Syracusans who were nearby overheard the commotion, realized what was happening, and now joined in on the battle while also shouting the code word, making a right proper mess of the situation.
Oh, they're sitting there. They pick up what the safety word is, I guess. What do you think it was back then? And since it was dark, it was hard for them to differentiate each other there, so. No wonder the Athenians lost the Peloponnesian War.
Another example of friendly fire takes place during the Siege of Jerusalem. Here, Roman soldiers ended up fighting one another in the dark passages of the Antonia Fortress. The confusion stemmed from the obscured environment and the fact that Jewish forces had actually made a habit of wearing any Roman armor they could scavenge from the battlefield.
Okay.
Thus, in conclusion, we could say that friendly fire was definitely a factor in the ancient battlefield, but that its risk really depended on the type in question. I absolutely love exploring topics like this one that so rarely get covered in traditional discussions of the battlefield, and hope that you've enjoyed the chat. If you like this type of content, definitely check out Ancient Warfare Magazine, our sponsor, which has fantastic coverage of all kinds of great subjects, and I'm buddies with them. Also, be sure to subscribe to the channel, ring the bell, and check out the rest of our content. See you in the next one.
Very cool. All right. So what'd you think? I mean, yeah, nothing out of the ordinary there, I would think. I liked a couple of the stories there, like you said, about, you know, like Greeks speaking different dialects so they couldn't differentiate from each other. That's an interesting one. So, and then the other ones were, you know, they made sense, like archers, if they are shooting too late because they are behind the infantry that's coming through or coming and charging, and then you get the archers coming in to try to soften up the lines, and you know, you wait too long, or the wind pattern changes. That made a lot of sense. The whole just the chaotic nature of battles too could definitely lend it to that. But I do think overall it does seem like, you know, in ancient battles it would be, you know, probably a lot less common. Today they do so much precision strikes, like you hear about like a precision air raid and how, you know, they try to get that and, you know, try to drop bombs and stuff within a few feet, right? And if, you know, if you miss that at all, if you miss that, you can end up, you know, hurting your own. And that happened a lot of times in places like World War II or Vietnam War and stuff like that. And there's a lot of stories of that, a lot of friendly fire, you know. But with such attempted ranged precision attacks that we use now, it makes a lot of sense. And you hear those awful stories. But I would be kind of interested is there a consensus about modern versus ancient, which had a higher percentage of friendly fire? I don't know. But it'd be interesting to learn about, because, you know, how warfare changes, I think, is interesting to me. So awesome. All right. So what did you guys think? Did you like this? I think, is this the first time I've seen a video from Invicta? I'm trying to remember if I have. This is kind of their style of looking at that sort of thing, but kind of focused on the military stuff. So that's cool too. And yeah, if you like this, make sure go down below, click original video link, get a view, give them a like, give them a subscription, and that'd be awesome. Now, just a reminder that this video was chosen by our patron pledgers. So thank you so much to our patron pledgers. Long goes long on that. Anybody that's channel members, you guys have been doing super chats and live streams. I really appreciate that. That really goes forward. And it's just important to me that you guys are trying to support history education, which is what this is all about. So anyway, we'll go ahead and end it here. Hope to see you guys soon, and we'll see you next time. Bye.